Ja, a warm welcome also from my side. My name is Thomas Schmidt from Hamburg University of Applied Sciences. I'm one of the co-organizers and session. Before this, I just learned this and want to share with you that this is actually the place where the European Internet basically started. So that was right across behind the wall at the Center for Wiskunde, the first internet pops arrived. Margot just told me that there was a first IXP here between the two buildings. And leads me to our first speaker. This is Jamie Jimenez. And he's also from the core of the internet, most notably from the core working group of the IETF. He's a co-chair there. Those are the guys who develop co-op and stuff. And as you may have seen already in the intro slide, he's a master researcher in Ericsson. He lives now in Helsinki, even though he comes from Spain. But what he did is was he studied at the U3CM, and decided, okay, I have to see other places in the world, and went to Stockholm and Helsinki, and stayed there. Welcome, Jamie.
So, thank you for the presentation and thank you for being here today. I will be talking about the process that it goes from research and development to products. I will mention some concrete use cases here, and I hope to give you ideas and inspire you to look forward to what to do next. Can you hear me well, or? All right, I'll get close. Is it better?
Yeah.
So I will start by mentioning that I work for Ericsson. So my company is a 100,000 people company, out of which about 650 work in research. So that's like 0.65 of the people working research in Ericsson. R&D, of course, is much larger, so the development side is much bigger. And we are, well, as you can see, all over the place, in my case, in Helsinki. We have multiple research focuses. So in the long run, we will be working on EU projects, 10 years time, for example, or working with academia, with other universities or other companies. 2 to 5 years time, our own internal research projects that we can then later on put into development. And then we have also a very short-term focus for specific proof of concepts with companies. And they pop up every now and then. Every year there is one or two. And of the bulk, I mean, of those 650 researchers, the majority are working on 3GPP and radio technologies. And yeah, and I didn't mention it, but for those of you, I mean, most of you probably don't know what Ericsson does. We don't do mobile phones, just to be clear. we do network equipment, so the base stations that your phones connect to, for example, and other infrastructure. So that's the main business, that's the main focus also of the R&D. And you may wonder, what is it to be a researcher? And actually, the expectation is often this. Here is Billy Lockwood playing the violin. So it's one person that is doing one thing, very focused on the thing. There's nothing outside, and you know, he doesn't need to care about what else is out there. He just focuses on that with great detail, great attention, perfectionist. And in practice, that is true to some extent, but in practice, it's more like this. I mean, this is a view widespread in the industry. You're more like Beth from Mary Poppins. So you have to be highly skilled on one thing, of course, but at the end of the day, you have to touch several things with some competence, and you need to be dependable, not only on the piece of the paper, if you're writing some academic publication, but you need to also be able to do presentations right now, or attend customer meetings, sell your idea, and you know, you end up doing quite many things. And I think this is something that happens also in the open source community. I think more and more, probably you cannot just focus on your piece of code as a standalone thing. You need to, you have a large community, you need to care for it, you need to groove it, and you need to also look into what is next for us, like Emmanuel there was saying before. And so I will start by, this is more or less the structure. I will mention a bit the IoT standards, because that's one area I know a bit better. So there has been about 18 years of the standards in the IETF, especially. They started early, 2005, roughly. There is this, I have gathered these 14 working groups. I think this is all. I hope I'm not missing any. And it all started first with the connectivity problem. Like some people wanted to build, to have IPv6 over 15.4, and they started with the 6LoWPAN working group and looking to have this connectivity available for constrained devices, then also the routing, then moving on to applications and security. Just to mention a few of those working groups, ROLL was the one doing Ripple, the routing protocol. LP1 is focusing on networks, any kind of C-Wave, 15.04, NFC, any kind of radio network out there and how to connect it to the internet. Focusing also on very low throughput type of networks. You have 6LoWPAN, creating this kind of IPv6 intermediary layer so that you can run IPv6 on these devices. And so then moving onto the application side, we have Core, which is my working group I'm co-chairing with Carsten Wormann, that did a very constrained application layer protocol for the IoT called CoAP. Is the type of communication is REST, so you have to think about it like a constrained HTTP, and it comes already with a lot of goodies. Like discovery is automatic. There is a well-known resource that is mandatory to implement. There is also other extension documents that facilitate that discovery. You have a resource directory where you can register your devices and find them. Then you have extensions for a specific use case. When you have, for instance, for a specific congestion problems, you have a congestion control enhanced algorithm, let's say, or you have for application layers, so you have enhanced security. And maybe I don't want to go into the details there, but there has been a lot of work that is taking over in other organizations. Then you have also CBOR, a constrained binary object representation. So it's like a very compressed way to send the data. And it's used, now in the IDF is used in many other working groups. Even CoAP, for example, we learned in the last IDF that it was used for denial of service attacks. So it's a signaling protocol there instead of something like CIP. Then you have the thing-to-thing RG, which is more focused in this long-term research and is very useful what they're producing. Very successful, I would say. And ideally, probably what they produce will be coming to Core or to other working groups elsewhere. But it's a nice community to, and you all know it already, actually. Then on the security side, originally the target was to have the connectivity part fixed. So there was work on how to enable DTLS on the constraint space. Then there was work on compression of signatures in COSI. And then also work on authentication, authorization mechanism in the ACE working group. And nowadays, as also mentioned by Manuel, the SUT working group is working on software updates for IoT. So the problem there essentially that when the device receives a binary, it needs to verify that the binary comes from the right party. And then there is something called a manifest file in a specific format that the device can basically use to verify at boot time whether to flash the new firmware or not, essentially. And also the PEEP, which is working on trusted execution environments. So this is the IDF. A lot of work there, another good technical contributions, but there's also other SDOs out there, like the biggest one would be W3C. Sorry, not the biggest in numbers, but very key to the whole ecosystem would be W3C. Everybody knows them from HTML and other internet, how do you call it, like, formatting. They are doing something called the theme description. So there is another, so on this is standardization layering, from connectivity to security, both transport, application, and so on, and you have now this semantic interoperability problem, which is that now we have the connectivity and we have devices talking to each other, but they are not only the serializations are different, but the data model they use is different. So for instance, in OMA, you have something called the IPSO objects. In OCF, you have some RAML files, part of the one IOTA, and in W3C, you have thing description, those are just three, but we have had workshops, IAB workshops, only on semantic interoperability, and there were like 100 different ways to represent the similar information. There's a lot of work on how to either do some mapping or do some translation and enable it just in a more or less seamless way. And at that, I think W3C is probably leading on that. Then you have OMA. So OMA is a very telco-oriented organization, Open Mobile Alliance. They have had things like, they have done things like OMA-EM or They were also in TS69 and other device management technologies. And now they have one called Live N2M, which is entirely based in CoMAP at the application layer at the moment. Like I like to think of Live N2M like a set of recipes of how to do common device management tasks in a RESTful fashion. So you don't have RPC tools or things like that. Then you have, and then it comes with an accompanying data model. And then also, maybe I went a bit too far to extend it on this, so let's continue. But essentially, there has been a lot of work on standardization. This is the kind of summary slide of all the RFCs that have been produced. You can even see at a chronological level how it started with connectivity and how we move on to other more interesting stuff. And then, so after this, with these standards and technologies, this is more or less the stack that quite a lot of companies out there are using at the moment. So I would like to add maybe narrowband IoT there. That's part of, I mean, there's a whole huge part of the picture that I am not even explaining in this presentation, which is the whole 3GPP and other telco standardization, which is huge. And they are producing now, they're focusing on 5G and narrowband IoT, but they leave it a bit outside of the scope, if you don't mind, because otherwise it would take forever. And then as you go higher in the stack, at the application layer, now you have to support also MQTT-based solutions, which are very common out there. So that's why I put it there, and I separated the application and device management layers, because normally these MQTT-based solutions are used for data gathering and aggregation. And on the device management side, at least we are pushing this Live N2M, mostly because it's, these type of standards are good for Ericsson, essentially. We sponsor it, we want it because it helps us to compete. For players that have kind of a vertical silo and that they have a monopoly, essentially they don't need competition, so they don't need the standards. They don't need interoperability, right? That's the whole point. And also because of the various standards, there is more eyes looking at it, there is better security. In some cases of these MQTT solutions by some companies, they essentially told us that they didn't care about security. So we are talking about different spaces. And I will go more in detail about that actually now. For people outside the telco space, maybe they want to know what is actually happening in the big player world, let's say. And this is the overview. I mean, I will explain why Matt is there later, but you can probably guess it. There's four big players. There's the telco infrastructure providers, there is the system integrators, cloud players, or ICT players, and then the operators. So for telco infrastructure providers like Ericsson, Nokia, Huawei, the biggest focus right now is 5G. That's the biggest thing by far. Like even, I think it was yesterday, it was announced that we had a deal for like in the range of billions with T-Mobile. So that's the kind of numbers they are talking about. And the same thing goes for Nokia and Huawei. But there is a lot of focus also on IoT. And we come with experience from connectivity and from device management. And there, all of these places, they have built some IoT platform that more or less looks the same, very, very similar, let's say, with very few modifications, also based on standards. And then you have the system integrators. We maybe don't have, they don't have such a strong knowledge about connectivity, perhaps. And they don't seem to, I might be outdated, but they don't seem to have an IoT platform as such. They have like analytics engines or specific tools there. But they're really great at integrating systems. So they can take several pieces, and when they get a big customer, they can do something. Then you have the cloud players that are usually sitting on a pile of money, and they could, you know, buy any of these companies 20 times over. And they are very strong at creating generic platforms, not so strong on the connectivity side. And I mean, they could also go one way or another. They're very good at this kind of generic platform application. And then you have the operators, which are like kind of a trump card in this environment right now, because some of them, they are, buying from others, but they're also building a lot of in-house solutions, often based on standards, other times more like really in-house and not so standard-based, like kind of homegrown. So the expectation there would be that these homegrown solutions are kind of hard to maintain. In the long run, maintaining this kind of thing at product level is kind of hard. You need to have a dedicated R&D investment that maybe they don't have. I mean, like as I mentioned, I don't know if I mentioned it before, but Ericsson, for instance, we dedicate like 15 to 20% of the budget to R&D, and similarly to Nokia, Huawei, and other players. I don't know the other companies. So So the point is that both telco and operators, they want to get out of this kind of pipe law role, by pipe role, like Mario there, getting out the pipe, and getting to other more juicy segments. So, and that's like the overarching picture. But in this kind of, among these big players, actually there's a lot of gaps there that leave a lot of room for smaller companies. Smaller, I'm not talking like tiny, I'm talking like millions in revenue, and that they can have a lot of potential to grow. And I have selected few, I have cherry picked actually, like some of them that use open source, they use standards, that I have somehow worked with them in some way. And I will enumerate them now actually, for maybe it will inspire some of you either to do the same thing or, you know, to do something in that space. So the first one is Jansi Networks. They were already before 2014, but I met them there. And they want to have a smart building solution that you deploy quickly, essentially. Like you can, you know, like the idea at the time and what they have now is that you go there with your devices, you plug it to the socket, maybe scan some QR codes for an app mechanism for verification, something like that, and you're good to go. A few seconds deployed. And they have been very successful on that, and they are using common standards that you all know, and with some modifications. They don't use vanilla repo, but they use another version of that. They use also open source, they use Tiki. I mean, the reason behind a lot of these choices actually is that they are co-located. Like the RISE, the Swedish Institute of Computer Science, that is now called RISE, is in Kista, co-located with Jansi, co-located with the Contiki developers, and that's because that's how it grew in that way. And they were like some control stock of this company actually was acquired a month ago when I was looking a bit into the details, the latest details, for like probably 50 million. So they're doing pretty well. Another example, and this one is probably my favorite of all of them, is the Smart Rockbot. So I met the guy in the Jens a few years ago in the IXO challenge that they won at the time, and they were basically, they have a lot of technology but they didn't know how to apply it, so they were looking for a use case, and the Rockbot came within the context of the PIM project. So it was done by Luleå University, and it was Jens and the other guy who still I can't remember right now, actually I never met him, but anyway, the point is that they had a problem, which was that the mines, they were using bolts, like metal bars essentially, to secure the structure of the mine. And I'm talking like in the range of a million or more per mine, depending on the size. And of course, that doesn't give much information. So they made some smart bolt. They added an accelerometer or a tension sensor. They added connectivity. They added also a LED that turns from red to green, which might sound silly, but actually helps a lot if you're there and you kind of check your system. And they won the competition, and they have this kind of digitalized mining area concept, and it's doing pretty well. And actually, I contacted Jens for this presentation, and he was telling me that he's quitting the university and focusing 100% on the company, which, by the way, is called ThingWave. I didn't mention it before. So it's a great concept. Then there is VersaSense. Again, I also met them in the context of the IPSO challenge. I was their coach, and they came with a solution for plug and play. They came with a solution, this kind of same kind of devices, but the focus was on real plug and play. So they said that they can need like a millionth of the time that is normally required to boost up the device. So you just connect it, there's some identification mechanism, and that's it. They didn't have a common data model, they wanted one. I suggested the IPSO one. And they have it as a differentiator. They don't want to be locked into, like, one of the reasons why they also use the standard is to avoid locking, which is also why we sponsor standards and why the majority of people want standards. And they have some, many of these companies, they do standards and they just put some sparkle there to have some differentiation. And they are doing very well, also coming from the university, from KU Leuven in Belgium. So again, like, standards, open source, university context, R&D context, and it seems to work. And I didn't mention it before also, remember, keep in mind what I said at the beginning of the presentation between perfection and versatility, because it's also, of course, related to all of these presentations. Then you have Husqvarna Gardena. So this one, was something happening in the context of an RFQ, a request for quotation we got, and that normally comes with a document explaining what they're planning to develop and what they're planning to do. And it came basically that they wanted to have smart mowers and smart gardening solutions and a way to do software upgrades and a way to do what Gardena has and supports now. So they the RFQ was really good. It came with all the standards, all of the open source stuff that we like. So we couldn't have much. I mean, essentially, it was pretty good already. And they developed it. I mean, some of these projects, the RFQ is the end of it. Essentially, there's no more further collaboration. In others, it could have been more. But still, they use these kind of standards. They use the same set of technologies I was mentioning before. And I was very disappointed, actually, a month ago, or roughly a month now, when I saw that their stock of Husqvarna crashed 19%. So, like, they changed so massively in the appetite. And because, you know, it's like, okay, these guys are focusing a lot in IoT and they're losing money, so what the hell? But then, actually, when you read the report, at least that's how I like to read it. I haven't contacted them for any information, but they say that they are exiting some what I would call legacy stuff. So petrol-powered land mowers and large garden tractors, especially in the US, and focusing on the other solutions that are growing. Like in the graph there, you go online, you can see that the Gardena and Husqvarna actually is growing year by year. The hype is lower, like you mentioned, Manuel, as well, but definitely it's growing. It's a real thing. And so I take it as a plus. And so another good example. And this one is a big company, of course, it's not like a tiny one. But, and another example is Acleo, for example. So Acleo doesn't do devices, but they are they're focusing on very software solutions for compression, for data compression. And they have a lot of expertise. I mean, Alexander Belov there in yellow, he has a lot of expertise in the ITF. He's co-chairing the LP1 working group, and he's contributing a lot to Core. And basically, they want to focus on these low throughput type of networks that desperately need compression because they don't have a lot of space. So things like Sigfox, for example. And they seem to be doing well. They started in Telecom Bretagne, which is also research. And they, in my opinion, they took advantage of the slowness of 3GPP because it took a long time to standardize NB-IoT. And then even when they standardized it, they came with two solutions. That's my understanding. I'm not a 3GPP expert. But I think they took advantage of that. And I mean, it's a good sign for them. And the next one is Realtrop. So this one is another case of a developer, a perfectionist that has to turn into a more versatile individual. So David Navarro, there in the picture, in both pictures, he was working for Intel, and then for one reason or another, he left the company and made his own company, Iotrop. He was building a Live with M2M client. He was one of the main developers in Wakama also, and then he built so he noticed that this kind of brownfield integration, when you have devices already out there, is kind of tough, especially if you don't know anything about protocols or networks or things like that. So what they have is an adaptation layer that allows you to very quickly or very easily, or more easily, use Live with M2M. His focus is definitely in Live with M2M. He's focusing on specific telco vendors. And as I said, like the fact that you have very big companies that cannot look at everything, leaves a lot of space for smaller ones to grow within the ecosystem. And actually, this is probably one of the few cases of a very small company participating and actively contributing in OMA, which I think is great. And so that's another very good example. If I'm going too fast, please tell me. The IKEA trophy. So this one is also a very interesting case. IKEA wanted to get into the smart lighting segment, something like Philips is doing. And of course, IKEA doesn't know how to do these things, so they hire a consulting company to build this. And this consulting company uses open standards and open source technologies to do it. And I think they succeeded. I mean, like I have IKEA trophy, it works very well. But the interesting thing is that nobody knew. So no one in the this standards community didn't know. I found out by chance on the internet because somebody posted the TLB format of the IPSO objects, and I said, aha, I know that. And nobody knew what the hell was that. And then we figured out that, okay, then if they're using IPSO, then it's likely that they're using that with more co-op, then, and so on. You know, you get the idea. It also runs on Riot now, because he has been ported, which is great, I think. But the takeaway from this is that you don't need to ask for permission to build these things. You can have a project, grab whatever you need and use it, and no one will be the wiser. Like, it's a great way to have this permissionless innovation that in the standards community people are talking about. So, yeah, so it's like a great example as well. And actually, the price point is pretty good also, which is getting there, essentially. Another one, so because of this kind of very generic NDAs we have, I cannot say the name, but it's not really hard to find out. But so this company does precision environmental monitoring. This the wooden balloon you have there, for example, in the picture, and other environmental monitoring tools in the roads. So this company it probably is not very well known outside Finland, but it's actually really big. And and you have the numbers there, 1,500 people, 300 million revenue, a lot of income, a lot of investment in R&D as well. But what they saw, I mean, actually the longest story here, from my point of view, is that we went there 2014, I think, trying to sell the open standards that approach. And they said, no, because we are in an advantageous position, why would we do that? But now, as things are developing, they see that there is value in it, because they don't need to invest so much in R&D, because it's done, because they have experts that have already looked into the technology, and there is one specific product branch that they would really like to have this that fits very well, the kind of open source protocols standard protocols and open source technologies. So they actually, we had a talk with them, and they have chosen this Live.M2M as one of the, as the one for this particular branch. They're using also CoA, because they're using Live.M2M. And they're also contributing that, I don't know what is the current status, but they were considering contributing back to open source and to standards, which is also good news. Another case, this is a bit more boring, but more recent also. So smart metering. I guess you guys, I mean, most people don't know anything about smart metering. I'm not claiming I know much, but actually they have millions of deployed devices out there in every country. They use a protocol called DLMS and COSEN. So it's again, DLMS for device management and COSEN for defining the objects or the structures in the gas meters. There's hundreds of them. It's like a bit like SNMP and the MIPS. So there's way too much information about every single detail of a gas meter or electricity meter out there. So first, from the standards point of view, they're looking into, okay, the next version of DLMS, what we have there. So they're looking into what has been done elsewhere, like in the ITF, for example. And then at the same time, they see one of these companies that I cannot name again is looking into COSEN and IPSO or other data models and how to map them. I don't think they're looking for a replacement for COSEN, but how to be able to use the same technologies. And then another part of the equation is that the PLC, power line communication, is kind of unreliable when you have when you're consuming electricity, essentially. So the bandwidth is limited, so they were looking into other radio technologies. And they will have a POC with using Narrowband IoT. And again, they are also looking into open standards, they're contributing actively in IPSO and INOMA. And probably even DLMS itself will come up with a new version that also has these standards. So again, the value of open source standards is clear for them. And then the last example I have here, I went really quickly actually through the slides, is the Ruby tag. So the Ruby tag, basically, at the end of last year, I got one of these prototype Ruby tags by chance. I really like the concept of having, because normally when you have a Raspberry Pi, you do the prototype in there, but you don't deploy that. But with the Ruby tag, you deploy the thing you are prototyping. So for a small scale projects, actually works pretty well. And it's a very good example of open hardware, but I think it's a very bad example of standardization because they essentially it's a beacon. And in the beacon, in the SSID, they have a URI, and then something called the payload, essentially the measurement in Eddystone format. So essentially the URI is pointing to nowhere. It's just the value. So what happens actually is that the phone gets the beacon and then that gets resolved to a server and then you download the CSS and HTML. And anyway, from the standards point of view, I don't like it, but it works. And it actually shows another example of how you design something for a purpose and then you use it for something else. This was originally intended to be for advertisements. So that when you walk around, you get an advertisement of a cinema nearby. and then it turns out to be for measurements, for sensor information, which I think is also interesting. But I mean, from the security point of view, it's kind of nice because you cannot access the device, it's just a beacon. But again, it's very simple. But as an open source project, it's going pretty well, it's growing fast, it supports the Riot, it's supported there also, is used as a platform for building other businesses on top, for cold chain tracking, for location, and the community is pretty active also, so it's going pretty well. And yeah, so basically, these were all the examples I had. A couple of cherry pick cases, of course, but it should give you inspiration for what to do next. This is, for instance, the kind of my view, which is very limited. Of course, I only know this, but I'm pretty sure there is hundreds of similar cases out there that probably you know. And actually, somebody should compile a list over at some point, by the way. It seems to be, they seem to have a common pattern in this with the open source and standards. Also a common pattern with coming from the research point of view or the purely development point of view, purely research point of view. But at some point, going back to the perfection versus versatility idea, somebody decided to jump a bit from the perfectionist point of view and create something. And usually it's like the one person leading the team or leading the group or leading the concept. And even if it doesn't work, it's great that there is people out there. And I'm sure that in the audience, like just like in Ericsson, we have like 0.65 people working in research, like very few of the Ericsson population. You are the expert. You are the technical. There's lack of people that have the technical skills to build this type of projects. There is lack of people with the initiative. So if anybody is poised for success, that will be essentially the people sitting in front of me. So I hope that some of you take the challenge and build something as well. And I can also add it to the list. And that's essentially it. I went 3 minutes, but maybe I talked a bit too fast. So the question go now, or?
Yes.
All right.
Well, let me oops. Get the mic on.
Oh, here we are. So, thank you, Jamie. We have time for questions or discussions.
I can go back to some few slides if you want, or just in specific cases.
Yeah. Well, while people are thinking, maybe I ask the question. The examples you mentioned were not directly from industry. Industry automation, and at least in Central Europe, Germany,
yep.
They talk a lot about what they call Industry 4.0.
Yep.
Is there anything you can say about this?
I don't know much about it. I know Carsten has some idea about several industrial cases.
Mm-hmm.
But essentially, I mean, I know some of the cases are using co-op, and that was more or less the extent of my knowledge on it.
There's also, I guess there's a bit of question on the state of mind. Many of the industries have the well-established, closed,
very close
systems,
yeah.
very locked in.
Yeah.
And this is also a question on how they develop, how their mindset develops.
So some industries are hesitant of, if they are in an advantageous position, they don't want to use standards because there is a risk for them. And then if they have some sort of quasi-monopoly, they do whatever they want. And for companies that need competition, those are the ones pushing the standardization because it allows for interoperability. And when you have that, then you can have multiple choices. And essentially for their business as well. And in a way, it's a bit of a selfish thing, but it's also good for, I mean, I believe in open standards as well. So I think it's good for everybody. There's a question there.
Okay.
Thank you. Good morning. Marco Honegaard, NTC. What's the role of regulation of all of this? Because you hear, especially in from the commission, there's quite a strong push to like, okay, push people into using a interoperable standard rather than have them choose one.
Yeah, I think very good. That's a very, very good question. I didn't mention it here, not to get into the political debate, but I think in many of these very big players, especially the ones that are really outrageously big. Like, I'm not going to say names, but everybody knows. Like, it's not, I mean, surprisingly, it's not really necessarily the traditional, maybe oligopoly is a big word, but like, you know, telco environment, for example. You have a big operator, and then three or four others. There is some competition. It's per country level. They are not global. So there is some monopolistic situation, but not really. But with these others, there doesn't seem to be any effort on regulation, which is kind of bizarre. And they are really scarily big in a way. So I think there should be much more regulation for those. Maybe they should start thinking about splitting companies and those things. From my point of view, by the way, like I'm not representing anybody in this. That's my own opinion.
More questions? Anna, this one.
Thanks for the talk. So you talk about standards, about open source, about solutions. Taking a step back, what would you say are some key challenges where we will need standards and solutions in the second step in the context of IoT right now?
Yeah, for me, I like the simple cases. I mean, for me, some of these other, so I see standards as a set of tools that you can use for your particular problem. You can, like I said before, like you can even misuse them or you can use them for different purposes. So they don't have standards don't really have a purpose per se. But I think there is a challenge, for instance, on the device side. There is not that many devices out there. There's a lot of prototyping boards, a lot of prototyping platforms, for instance, but there is not a lot of, like, you cannot buy off the shelf a lot of IoT devices with the stack that I want. There is a lot of in-house vertical solution. Think about the wearables, for example. Like, those are, you cannot do much with those. You cannot play with them. And what we need is more like the HTTP and HTML of the IoT. That was what enabled people to run their own things and to try and to play around, essentially. So, like, I think maybe if the device side becomes very open and very focused on this, we have a strong chance to have more of the IoT that we want. Yeah. I don't know if I answered the question. Yeah. All right. Yeah.
So this brings me to an additional question. You mentioned the cloud platforms and we talked about CoAP. Most of the cloud platforms support MQTT.
Yeah.
Can you say something about the future of MQTT?
Yeah, it sucks. I don't like it. it sucks. MQTT was there before, and it's really simple to start to play with. I have no problem with MQTT. I think it's great. In some cases, people could probably use it. It's lacking in a lot of things. So, in some cases, I've been in some customer meetings in which they are thinking really short term. And they say, well, we took MQTT because we need, by end of 2018, we need to be selling this. And then I say, well, but what about this security? I mean, I can, in Black Hat, for instance, there was this, someone was subscribing to hashtag and they were getting everything about the MQTT traffic. And that's a feature. It's not even as a security vulnerability. So, and then the answer of this guy actually was, we don't care about security. We don't have time for that. So, like, there's different views, different design views. Some people are really focusing on the now. Others are thinking more, like, a bit more future ahead. I like CoAP. I think it's great. And it would be great if more cloud providers could support it. But for them, in their own interest, I guess, they also want to do data aggregation. And if there is not a lot of demand from the device side, they don't have strong incentives to support it. Although some of them do support it, by the way. Like, I think Microsoft IoT Hub technology. For Azure, that support CoAP. But it would be great if it was more streamlined, to be honest.
Ah.
Hi, can you say something about the interaction between open source and patents? The reason is that, you know, if you try to commercialize some idea, if everything's open, then the company could just copy it, you know, and not pay you, right? So I think we're all in favor of open source, but at some point you have all these startups, how do they navigate their differentiation and monetize all their efforts?
Yeah, so even I do have patents on my name. So for companies my philosophy at least is not to do patents on the stuff that needs to be standard and focus on patents on optimizations that you can sell. And I think that's what many of these small companies, some of the companies I mentioned before, they do have patents as well. on their optimizations. And it's important because at the end of the day, you need to have a product that needs to be competitive. And if somebody copies you, then you're done. I mean, there's no product. But there needs to be a trade-off, of course. I think it has to do also with the licensing. Like, the, for instance, in Ericsson, we support this fair and reasonable and non-discriminatory kind of approach. But essentially what happens is that the big player, they do have a lot of patents, but it's mostly for protection. It's not like they are, basically, if the other guy has this stack of patents, you need to have a similar stack of patents, otherwise you will get sued. For smaller companies, it's more like to protect their specific solution so that nobody copies them, and then later on they can go and sell it, and the other bigger player has to buy them. I encourage for anyone doing a small company, if they have something really new, they should probably do a patent on it, I think. But they, of course, like maybe they, this is not, I don't know, the stand of Riot actually on patents, I guess, is, it was
LGPL,
or wasn't it Apache? I don't remember actually.
No, it's
LGPL. All right. So,
remind that software patents are still illegal in Europe?
It depends on the software patent. But like, I mean, I think most of these patents actually they're on radio technologies that are done in 3GPP type of standards. But I mean, I don't know. Like, I think if you, as I said, if you have a small company and you have something really new, you probably should protect it. If you want to make business.
Do you have room for more questions or discussions? Otherwise, we will have, we thank Jamie again.
And thank you all. By the way, I'm super honored to be here. This is my first keynote of this type. I'm super happy about it. Thanks.
And we will have a coffee break now, and Jamie will be here, and everybody is welcome to discuss.